It's hard to believe I shot this film 10 years ago. I started shooting June 2000, and we shot 1 month, and then we edited about 1 month, and then it had a premiere at the Seoul Net Festival in August 2000. So this is a documentary done very quickly. I never done any project like this fast. So you will see some limitation I had, but every time I screened this film, I always felt like I am inspired by three wonderful actresses, their love for acting, their passion for what they want to do, and that
one of the panels where,
and that's what I love about this project. So I hopefully, maybe you feel the same way when you walk out from the screening. This is only 38 minutes, so I'll do the Q&A after the screening. Esther?
Hi everyone, I can't believe you guys are here. It's so nice outside. Well, thanks for coming, and you'll see this. I can't believe you gave it away that it was 10 years ago. So this was my first independent film project that I'd ever done as soon as I graduated. So I have a very, very special place in my heart for this project, and we can talk about it afterwards. So thanks.
What kind of actor do we want to become?
I want to do theater, I want to do film, I want to do TV, I want to do it all. You know, I would not mind being a household name, but that's not my number one goal.
I think if I were to model my career after someone, I think it would be someone like John Malkovich. Have my own theater company.
Put in a call for you to make
my own stuff, but still do great projects on film and do it all.
From my point of view right now, it's like to have the power to choose. I want to be in that position.
What did you do to die today at a minute or two to two?
This show is all about like the commercial actress. I play like a commercial actress.
Yes, yes, yes. I look really great.
You only have like 5 minutes in your daily life to do like the one thing you really like, and it's easy to forget that you really want to focus on this.
They are taller than any of the Asiatics we have here in America, and they are somewhat kinder and more solid.
I think that's where I shine, and I think we do have an obligation to, you know, to shine out what we do best.
Where should we put her?
It's like giving birth. Like in those moments, you forget about the pain. You know, you forget about all those other things that you went through to get that. You know, and but that's, those moments are what we live for.
Koreans don't take to acting so much. They make too much money being green grocers.
So when I first told my parents that I wanted to go to a university that had a drama and theater film department, my mother's reaction was, first of all, A, we're not paying for your education. And my father was more on the persuasive tactic. He was just like, no, Esther, really, you should really think about it more deeply. And you're too smart to be just, you know, kind of spending your time and, you know, spending your energy pursuing that career. So I wasn't really able to go to a university that had that department. But once I got to Yale, it was a different story. And so my parents would tell, you know, their friends, oh, my daughter is a graduate student at Yale drama school. Oh, she studies acting, you know, so. And then now they're much more supportive. And I'm sure you guys have similar experiences like me.
It was hard for me too. In the beginning, they were like, they thought it was a phase that I was going to get over. Mm-hmm. You know, I was studying it in college, and they were like, oh, well, you know, this is the time for her to explore, and she'll get over it.
Right.
And when they started to realize that I was serious about it, they got really worried, and they were like, you know, trying to convince me to go into any other field.
Mm-hmm. When I told them, they were like, my mom was like laughing. She's like, she goes, ukkijima, you know, like, how can you be an actress, you know, like, first of all, she's like, you're not that pretty, Vivian, you know, and I'm like, and I'm like, what? You don't have to be pretty to be an actress, you know, like, you can, you know, I'm going to be in theater, and like, blah, blah, blah. And yeah, it was like really hard. My dad didn't talk to me for like a year, And, wow. and they were totally like your parents. They were like, well, we're not going to support you. Mm-hmm. If you
talent will
acting school or whatever. So it's all up to you.
We'll take some questions from the audience. Yes?
Is everyone still in the business?
Yes. well, Esther, she can tell her own story to you directly. And Vivian, I just heard from Esther. She's in a TV program.
I think it's all about Ted, all about someone.
So she's on television, but she also did 2 years ago when I saw Vivian. I was in LA 2 years ago briefly, and I saw Vivian. And she told me she did a film with comedian.
Somebody IMDb.
No.
connected to
Jim Carrey. Jim Carrey's last film. She had a supporting role, so she's still in LA. And the funny thing is, we shot this 2000, and then 2001, end of 2001. This film actually was nominated for a media award. And by then, Esther was already there. Vivian was thinking about going to move to LA. And Jina was about to move too, or she was already there. And three actresses, year after we shot this film, they're already living in LA, pursuing their goal as a film and video. Because I told them, theater, you can always, some ways, you have more time, for instance, to be an actress, but for film or television, you have to be certain age, especially in America. You have to look certain ways. So when you are young, I think it's better to pursue film and television first than theater. So I encouraged them to consider, you know, even moving to LA, and they somehow did it. And so, and Jina, who pursued her career a couple years there, and then she got married, and now she lives in Germany.
Wow.
Yeah, and she has a son, and she trying to do a little like a theater work there, so it's very interesting. Yes?
Why make a film about theater in New York as opposed to film in LA? Why choose?
Why it was in New York?
Yeah, why choose theater in New York as opposed to, say, like, film?
I just want to comment. When I wrote a proposal was, this was actually a commissioned piece by Film Festival in Korea, Seoul Net Festival, their international internet film festival. And that was their first year, and they had some proposal.
So
they want to fund some film, was short film. So I wrote a proposal. Basically, I said, well, I'm a director, but I know some of my friends are an actor, and it seems like some ways they have more obstacle to climb up as Asian American. And so I asked them whether I could do little documentary about them to, I mean, sometimes, you know, you know some kind of limit is there, but you don't know the whole story. That's why I decided to do it. And I decided to do this little short documentary about actress. And then I picked these three actresses, and we have a little budget, so we have to shoot it in New York. We don't have any budget to travel LA or anything, so we kind of limit ourselves in New York. And New York, there's more actually theater work than film and television at the time, and they're young in terms of their career trajectory. So, I mean, I think Jina and Vivian already did some commercials in New York by then, but nothing really big or anything yet. So we just focused on what they were really doing in that summer of 2000. So that's what we did. And Esther and I were joking last year, like, if somebody fund us, we can maybe do the sequel or something 10 years later. And we still can do it because, again, Esther and Vivian still pursuing their career, and Jina, slightly different. But it'll be interesting to see, you know, what
my dad
and how their 10 years is going to be. It's going to be a really great story. Yeah. But somebody has to come up with the proposals. Yes?
What type of work is industrial work that one of the actresses spoke of?
Well, that's like, the corporation. They need a presentation. They sometimes hire actor and actresses, okay, do the presentation. Or it's like an info commercial. That's called industrial work, too. Yeah, so it's a corporate presentation or a kind of info commercial kind of work. It's pretty well paid. I mean, I don't know about nowadays, but 10 years ago, it was okay.
I wanted to ask Esther, how was your transition from New York to LA when you decided to go a year from when this was shot? How was that for you?
I look back at that time and I was like, wow, I was really crazy to do this. I didn't really have any base in Los Angeles. All my friends and kind of what I had established was here in New York City. And at the time, I thought I was going out to do a reconnaissance. I was going to check it out and see what LA's all about. And for me, timing-wise, I had moved out right before 9/11, and then actually I was flying that morning. I had come back to New York to still take care of some of my unresolved things here in New York, and I remember I was down in Wall Street and I went to the Bat Theater and I was watching a show. The next morning I had to get up really early to take that morning flight, and I had a very big experience that was shared with all the New Yorkers, of course, and so I ended up staying there longer and then really establishing my base there. So that was kind of the transition for me. And at the time, especially for the arts in New York, it was like hit so bad. Everybody was just like, it's so great that you had just missed it. But I was actually up in flight and we were grounded for 4 days. JetBlue was not really a well-known aircraft at the time, but they were the first ones that had digital TV. So I was watching things live, starting from the second World Trade Center on MSNBC. So it was an extraordinarily difficult transition from New York to LA because of everything, historically, emotionally, professionally. And also, at the time, it was interesting because I had graduated from grad school, but I really didn't have on-site experience. I had another previous graduate degree before Yale. Or what he wanted to share. I grew up in Seoul, Korea, so I'm a true fop. I was fresh off the plane, and so I didn't have any LA, New York experience working as an actress, so I was, in a good way, very idealistic. In a bad way, I wasn't savvy about the business. I didn't know. I didn't know agents. I didn't know about commercials. I didn't know stereotypes. I didn't know how I would get boxed in. So I say that was helpful because it was the unknown, or I came from the majority, so I had a very different perspective. But clearly, it was very, very clear after school and after my some extraordinary experiences that I had due to my mentors. I had worked with Anna Deavere Smith and Ping Chong right out of school, and they're just the great masters, and I was very fortunate to have them as my mentors. But I realized kind of the reality of New York City. And I had to make a choice at that time. Either I was going to be a generative artist like Ping Chong and do my own work and develop and do an international festival circuit, or I was going to have to be much more mainstream. I had thought when I was in school, I was like, I'm going to do classical work and Shakespeare and be touring. And I was like, wow, I can't even get auditions. And I know this is not because I'm not talented. I know it's not because I'm not trained. So I remember discussing with a lot of my friends at the time, and Yunah being one as well, and they were a lot of my friends at the time were independent filmmakers, and they were like, why not LA? And LA was just so random to me. I had no ties there, and I of course grew up with movies, but not really American TV shows. That was never really my goal. And I had a lot of encouragement of, you have the deliverables that you can make it, so you should consider it. So I was just like, okay. And so I had to make a choice at that time. And actually, even Ping Chong at the time had mentioned he felt that Asian American artists in the States continued not to be competitive because there weren't enough opportunities to continue that competitiveness. And he actually encouraged me to think about Los Angeles as well, because work-wise, there's just much more work. There's just 5 to 7 times more, or there used to be more work. Whether it be crappy work, whether it be stereotypical work, whatever it is, there was still much more work in LA. And that's just a city built on the industry. So that was part of my transition and things that I wanted to share with people possibly who are in the industry or considering it.
Well, I didn't really understand what you said about Asian Americans are not the competitive state.
You got to continuously work, and you got to continuously work with good colleagues and then good projects, and to continue to stay in the game. It's that competitiveness dies out when you don't get those opportunities. So that's what he was talking about.
Yes. How are you able to stay in the game if the work that's offered to you is very, I don't know if that's the case, but
sure,
it's stereotypical, mm-hmm, or doesn't, you know, box you in some way? I'm assuming that is the case.
I can only speak for myself of how I've navigated it. I've just used all my facilities possible. I think one of the things that right now I feel like the next generation that's coming up has great competitiveness, because you can self-generate your work. YouTube wasn't in the scene at all. You know, digital cameras weren't that cheap. You know what I mean? Like, now it's really, really different. And I think in a good way, I did have this non-traditional way of approaching things. And so I had a theater background. I knew I had a deliverable look, so to speak, for Hollywood. I also had mentorship in writing. So I had a few plays that I had written. And so it's kind of coming full circle around now with my solo performance work. I had strong mentors, or I tracked how they made their own stamp, how they generated their own work. I still worked commercially to do commercial work on TV, so that was my bread and butter. And so I had to navigate through everything and really approach it as my own entrepreneurial my company. I was the CEO, I was paying myself, I had to do my own PR, marketing, getting news out, looking for my own work, and I think that's the way now. It's shifted more, I think, and I feel that, cross-pollinate, which was very confusing at the time, I think, for people, and they viewed you in a certain way. And I said, Sam Shepard could do it. If a white man can do it, I can do it. Like, that was just my attitude. Like, you cannot tell me I can't do it. Why? Because, and there would be people who were either resistant or just didn't view it in that way. And I think that's shifted a lot.
Well, one thing I can add to what Esther already said is when we were shooting this 10 years ago, I mean, I knew Esther a little bit, but I don't know her that well. But one thing really struck me so much was she was really working hard. I mean, she did this monologue and she asked me to find a place so she can be hers and everything. But the process of shooting this documentary, I can tell this woman works really hard. I mean, besides being she's well-educated and intelligent and savvy, she works harder than anybody else. That really impressed me too. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yes.
I have just a comment and a question. I'm so glad I'm here tonight, and I really needed to hear this. I'm an actress and a writer, and this crazy thing, like about a month ago, I had this dream. I woke up, I can't remember my dream, but I just had this very clear thought that I had to go to LA. Mm-hmm. And I feel like it's crazy because I worked so hard this past year. I finally got myself 2 commercial agents, and knock on wood, possibly this week, a legit agent. Mm-hmm. But I think I'm about to throw it off. I don't know what to do because I worked so hard in the last few years to create this, you know, somewhat of a career here in New York. And I had this dream.
sabbatical.
And I went on Craigslist and started looking for apartments, and I was like, what am I doing? But I just had this like compulsion. I started cleaning my apartment and packing. And I needed to hear this, so thank you. But the question was, do you think that 10 years now that culturally we're moving away more away from stereotypes on, you know, as far as the roles that you're being offered, are you finding more diversity in the kinds of roles that you're getting versus like, you know, the typical, stereotypical kind of Asian roles? So,
yeah. Esther can answer that.
I think for sure. I think there's just a, it's a really exciting time right now in Los Angeles and just more mainstream. But I've actually not been in the thick of all of that for the past almost about a year and a half, because I've been doing my own show and I've been doing my own work, and I've actually interconnected a lot of my personal life and goals that are actually wider and much more interesting for me. So I've done a lot of thought leadership work. I was a TED fellow. I was a Korean American leadership fellow. So I've been traveling a lot internationally and speaking and doing a lot more educational, politically, socially involved work. Right now it's a little bit less than the auditions that I've been going out on, but more so me as a viewer seeing what's going out there. So that's for sure. I think still, at least from my experience, still my in to Hollywood and a lot, most of the TV work that I've done has not been because of my MFA in acting. It was because I spoke Korean fluently. Mm. And from there, I was able to like wedge myself in, but that was a very interesting experience for me. And at least that was my experience. I do think you need to have some kind of in some way and to build upon that. But it's changed a lot, but I still think that there needs to be much more empowerment and power and choice making in the side of production. And that comes from not only writing, showrunners, people who really make the decision. And I don't think it necessarily has to be the way that Hollywood used to be. There's a lot more people now who really, including myself, I don't watch TV that much. And I don't have time. I'm not super interested. internet accessibility with everything. I'm interested in what's going on in the world right now. And so I think that has to be part of, I know that has cachet. I know for me, I have
in your head to do before you do.
Oh, Esther has all this Hollywood credits and whatnot. But I think it's shifting and morphing a lot. And honestly, I think Hollywood has been since really the SAG strike and the writer strike. Mm-hmm. So it's been a few years now, about 5-6 years, where they're just really trying to figure out what the next step is and what's going on, and trying to reinvent themselves. So which means if that time comes when you have an innovative idea or something very interesting and you have a lot more to offer than just a so you have to approach it, I think, I believe, in a more polymathic, in a much more hybrid way. And I think mainstream is trying to do that as well.
Also, reality television, that's really dominate TV now, so.
That just started, yeah, then as well.
It wasn't like the 10 years ago.
So. Yeah, and.
So, I mean, there are a lot of things we can talk about, but.
Lots have happened in 10 years.
Yeah, but.
I was just thinking, I was in junior high in the late 90s, and I remember watching TV. It was like a commercial. I feel it was like a cell phone commercial or something. And I remember seeing an Asian guy, and it was like the first time I remember seeing like an Asian like guy just on like a commercial. And I was like, because I remember watching, you know, I watched cartoons all my like childhood, and never saw an Asian person on a commercial. And that was more like, I was like 97 or something. I was like, there was an Asian guy on TV, on a commercial. And now you see them like a lot more in commercials all the time or in TV shows. Like, I don't know, I was just thinking about like when this was shot and how things maybe, I mean,
I think things have changed a lot.
So should she go back to the West Coast?
That is not anyone's.
Are there more opportunities there for her?
I mean, for young person, I would say just follow your heart and then see what happens. And then maybe she might be able to be like Esther, bi-coastal. You go back and forth. You do some interesting theater here. You go to LA, do some TV work or film. Hopefully, and maybe, you know. I got really hooked. Like Esther, you have to be creative being an actress. That's the only way you can survive.
Where do you see yourself? How do you see yourself by 10 years? What is the peak in your career?
I have never really thought about a particular peak.
More to come. I think so. More to come for Esther.
When I grow older, I'm just going to put on my Korean accent so I could just play a lot of auntie roles. And I'll just be like, I haven't thought about that. I think it's, if you, I would like to share this TED Talk that Elizabeth Gilbert, she did a TED Talk about being an artist and how precious it is to think about a peak and having certain things. I think, I do think it's just a trajectory of the projects and the journey itself. I never thought my solo performance piece would be this full length entity when it started. I did have a goal and things that I thought about, but for me right now, if I think about 5-10 years, it's I'm not skirting the question at all. It's not nothing like, oh, I have to do this film, or I think it is my personal work and being able to be in a position to make it happen. That's another thing, because there's tons of great ideas. There's enormous amount of talent out there. There's so many things that need to be in place to make things really happen, and which is why I am extraordinarily supportive, and I really, really think it's important that people fund Yunah's work. And no, it's so important, because there's a fabric that has been built that is, as an Asian American community, we're much we're weaker. Politically, we're not as strong as a voice. Financially, there isn't a lot of support that should make a lot of things happen. There aren't a lot of activism, even in a way of just community-wise. For instance, talking about grants and fundings, and independent artists, we always talk about this, right? Like, how can we make this happen? Where are the funds going to come from? It's not a lack of ideas and whatnot. And I went to one of the panels where one of the panelists was saying, anybody who's in a position to be able to do so needs to be on boards and needs to be on the selection committee for grants. And I was just like, I've never thought of that. I'm always on the other end of for hire or applying for grants. And that's not, even for somebody like me, a place where I'd like thought about. And so that all has to interconnect. And friends that you can rely on and call in, and that person can put in a call for you to make certain things happen. And so I think on a wider social level, the community has to really, if you want to see something get made, there has to be a lot of enablers, because there's a lot of talent out there, and at least for myself and a lot of my friends, Yunah is an absolute enabler, and you become both, but there's only so much time and resources, and a lot of times my art sacrifices because I'm trying to get the e-blast and da-da-da, secure the funding and the space and do a lot of operational stuff where I know my talent will carry or at least cover it, but I know it hasn't had its due place and what other artistic endeavors might have already supported in-house. So, you know what? I actually forgot your question.
Can I answer it?
I feel like I just wandered all over the place.
Yeah, again, just have to be creative in every aspect of life in a way to try to get things done and, you know.
I just want to comment on the creative part of it and also what I've noticed being in Hollywood. There's a lot of guys that I've met who are doing projects because they play ice hockey and poker in a certain group. It's just straight up the reality.
Like a research funding.
My dad has always been on my case for not learning golf. I can't stand it. I just can't stand golf. I don't know if this is at all PC for me to say at an Asian American. But the point being as well, the golfing community, that's where deals are cut. That ice hockey guy that I just was talking with because he was a friend of my friend was not inspiring to me in terms of his story or what he wanted to share, and I'm not putting
him of Chinese in America in
mind. He didn't come from an artistic background. I know on the operational side of it getting done probably is ahead of a lot of people because it's a specific industry kind of celebrity oriented ice hockey group. There's a lot of San Francisco Palo Alto money that comes down where these cats have just made a lot of money and they've hooked up with their Stanford friends and like, let's do a project and make a film. That's how it happens a lot of times. And it really, and I think that's maybe perhaps a little bit different from LA and New York. New York definitely has a much stronger tradition, and you will not survive if you don't have the deliverables in terms of the quality. But still, that was a real, and you know, sometimes myself included and my colleagues will get very annoyed or just angry about the situation, but that's just the reality and how what it takes to get things done. So I guess from that, I just want to offer just using all your resources and other people are doing it and making it happen. And I think what's exciting about Asian Americans is that I do feel it doesn't have to be one or the other anymore. I think you could be a really great lawyer and earn like good money and then say, I'm gonna take a sabbatical for whatever, a year or two, and get together with the friends and, right? And just get it off the ground and get it out there. Why not? Everybody else is doing it.
Yunah, I had a question about your coming project, the one that's in progress, about the anime Wong project. Mm-hmm. I guess I want to hear more about it, first mm-hmm. of all. I wondered if this is like a thread in your work, like obviously she was a pioneer mm-hmm. and went through incredible hardships that I guess in our generation that's even hard to imagine that was reality, and I wondered if that was already in your head to do before you did this documentary, if it's related at all, or I'm just curious.
Right. I knew Anna Mae Wong way before I did this project. Yeah. I was always interested in her, yeah. admire her, you know, screen presence and all that, but I didn't know much about it really. I mean, I read about here and there, but not much, but until I went to library to do some research to find more about her, I got really hooked. And then, still I have no idea I'm gonna do anything about that. Well, there are a lot of projects like that you have in your head for many, many years, but you still have to find a way to tell the story. So I wasn't doing anything. And then the project, beginning of 2000, I got an offer that I should submit a proposal for a documentary or a short film. So I did that, and then we finished and had a screening in by August. And then I was wrapping up another film, another documentary, Between the Line. And I had some time at the time, so I went back again to do some research about Anna Mae Wong, because after I wrap up this film, I still felt like this is the film, there's no happy ending, or it's just kind of, you feel like this is ongoing thing, and then you go all the way back, Anna Mae Wong, 1920s and 1930s. So I did more research, and then I wrote a proposal, and then I got a research funding from New York State Council on the Art. So I started shooting interview by 2003. And then I'm still working on it, and I'm almost done. I just had a screening at the Museum of Chinese in America in March. Had a really great response from audience. And I felt really great because it was mostly Chinese American, Asian audience. They really reacted to their big star. And I really feel confident about the editing, how it went through. So right now I'm really trying to finish. So I'm doing music recording 2 weeks from now and try to finish by maybe early summer. So it's almost done. The cut that I show at the Museum of Chinese America MoCA was a fine cut. It's pretty finished length, 56 minutes. So I have a waiting list, I mean a mailing list. I'll get today, people who came today, I can put you into my mailing list and come to the screening when it's have a screening in New York, maybe later this year or next year. Yeah. But that anime, one thing I can tell face is a technique. She's, you know, somebody, white actor, somebody again like Esther who worked really hard. She's talented. She's almost like grew up in a film business because she started so early. She was a young teenager, become an extra, and then in her early 20s, she was already a star in Hollywood. And then she moved to Europe and did more work, and then coming back and become another big star. And the obstacle she had was just tremendous because basically at the time in Hollywood, there's no Asian actor playing Asian role. Basically, it's called yellow face. It's a technique where white actor make their eyes, like Asian eyes, tighter, and you know, like a makeups and other cosmetics and other cosmetic Asians. So all this Caucasian actor play their Asian role. But she was the only really authentic Asian woman playing Asian roles. So it's incredible. But again, without her talent and really passion and also savvy, she really was good businesswoman, how to handle her business affair very well. But then again, I've been in contact with Esther past 10 years since we shot this film together. I mean, sometimes I'm really struck by like how Esther's working. There's a similarity that, you know, like Anna Mae Wong, she knows you have to, there's no rule to play this game, being an actress in Hollywood or anywhere else. You just have to be creative. But the way she kind of navigating the whole thing just strike me like Anna Mae Wong. And again, hardworking. That's the only way, I think, besides being well connected and all that, being creative.
Do you know if it's harder for Asian men in Hollywood than it is for Asian women?
You know, we've had this discussion, and it's hard to gauge. I know for my
also savvy, she really
male friends, some think so, yes. Some have had good opportunities just because they were very specific and they spoke the other language. I think, again, right now it's different. I was just watching that new comedy, Rules of Engagement.
Business,
and so that's
fair,
now fair. Become one of the roles, the sidekick assistant, whether it be gay or
well. And
usually tends to, I've been noticing Asian American male casting. They're not the leads, but they're the yummy, they're kind of the fun parts. So I think the gender, I think it's a little tricky. So I don't know if I can fully answer that comprehensively. I know there's a tendency to think that it's harder for Asian American men, but from my perspective, it's hard to think, and I always think it's actually much more gender-based for me and with the industry than it is about ethnicity. We've only had Kathleen Bigelow is the first honored and awarded film director ever ever in the history of the Academy Awards. Ever.
80 years, yeah.
So there's an extraordinarily harsh gender bias and presence in the arts.
Being an actress in
media, period. So I find that to be much more of a challenge.
I read somewhere, I think a year ago, that Aaron Yu, he's kind of like a young...
Yeah, I knew Aaron.
It was like an Asian American magazine, something like that. He was getting more work that year than Lucy Liu, like, statistically, so I don't think he's got... I don't know if that means anything, but it's just...
You probably recognize him. He's actually in that young teenage category. And what was the big one? Was it something 13 about the Yale students going to Vegas and they kind of cleaned house?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
20 was 13. Where did I get that? Jack. So you'd recognize him probably. And he's one of those working actors. Just, you know, he's just not a household name, but Aaron works all the time.
Any other questions for Yunah and Esther? If not, I'd like to give them a round of applause.